Our conversation. How many of would want recorders on our phone so that everything that we said, every conversation that we shared, could be heard by anybody. How saintly do you feel when you think about the possibility of having all of your actions, all of your conversations recorded and listened to by someone? I use my credit card, my bank card, for most of my purchases these days. And when I go online to pay that bill, there is a pie chart that shows me where I spent all that money. What would your pie chart look like? Does your pie chart look like you are a saint of God? Or does it look like you're caught up with the pleasures of the world? Where does our money go? Does it make us look or feel saintly? We have sung for all the saints who from their labors rest. Are we going to be in that number? Do you believe that you are in that number who will be sung about when God calls you home? Amen. All too often we think of saints as those who have died. And it's easy to think about those folks who have died as saints because if they died and done some pretty good things in their life, then that's often all that we remember. And that's the good news. That's really a blessing. When I'm dead, I pray that you remember not the bad things that you know about me, but what good things God allowed me to do. I pray that you will remember the positive things as you remember today those individuals that we name and that we remember in our heart. That we remember the saintly things, the positive things that God enabled them to accomplish. As we gather again today and consider for a few moments where are the saints or who are the saints, we hear in this text, it reminds us in this text that the saints of God cannot be counted. That's good to know. In other words, you and I, nor anyone else, can predetermine the number of God's saints. You know, there are times when we get an invitation to join a group, to go to a party, to be a part of an organization, but that organization or that party probably has a cap number. There are so many folk that can be invited, and then the invitation is cut off. It has to be closed. Even in our reading from Revelation, there appears to be a cutoff number for those around the throne. We read that there are 144,000 who were sealed from the 12 Jewish tribes. But that's not the end of the story. After that, the text says that there was a number that John saw, a number that could not be counted. The salvation of God is not just extended to that symbolic 144,000 from the tribes of Israel, from the Jews, but God's salvation is extended to all. And the number who are blessed by God's invitation is more than can be counted. More than Jews. It includes the Gentiles. And that's good news. That means we are in the number when the saints go marching in. The text from Revelation, as we are being reminded in the Bible class that we are sharing, was written to encourage an oppressor. It was not written to frighten, even though there are some scary scenes in it. It was not written to determine the mark of the beast or the Antichrist. It was not written to predict Big Brother watching over us. It was not written to cause us to worry about a chip being placed under our skin so that we could make purchases or a mark being placed on us so that we could survive in the world. It was not written to predict the destruction of the world through some major world war. It was written to provide hope and comfort and victory and peace to the believer who was oppressed on every side. God gives John this revelation while he is in exile on the island of Patmos. Seven churches would receive a letter. The letters to the seven churches represent the entire kingdom of God on the earth. And the seven churches represent all the issues and all the churches that all believers will experience at one time or another. But it also is a reminder that God sees them. God sees their work. God sees their heart. God knows all about them. He knows exactly what is going on in their world. He knows all about their challenges. He sees everything that they do and what they do not do. And it is a word of encouragement to know that God sees them. They are being oppressed by their government. They didn't have the greatest respect for their leaders. They feared for their lives. They couldn't worship as they wanted. They were being ruled with a harsh hand. Sometimes they felt all by themselves. And John wanted them to know, God wanted them to know, that the eyes of God was on them. The piercing, all-seeing eyes of God was on them. And guess what, my brothers and my sisters? The piercing, all-seeing eyes of God are always on you and me. Sometimes folk will post things online about things that they're doing or whatever's going on in their world or what they got on and all that kind of stuff. Somebody put some eyes on there to say, we're watching you. I'm looking at you. I got my eyes on you. God is watching us 24/7. And it can be a word of comfort. Word of comfort in the revelations in John for the people of John's day and for us is that God sees us in our struggle. God sees us in our challenges. He sees us in our financial situation. God sees and God knows all about our struggle. He knows the questions that you have for today and tomorrow. And because he knows, because he sees where you are, because his eye is on you, consider yourself blessed. No matter what's going on, you are blessed. Because God has his eye on you. God is not going to watch you and not provide for you. God is not going to have his eyes on you and not be a fence of protection all around you. That's why Matthew shares this wonderful message in the Beatitudes in our reading from the Gospel today. No matter where they are, Matthew reminds them that God is blessing them. You know, we've been traveling through Matthew all of this liturgical year. And these last couple of weeks in reading from Matthew has really challenged us. Recall some of the messages that Matthew left us these last couple of weeks. Sometimes they don't make us feel very saintly. We heard, many are called, but few are chosen. We heard, therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing fruit. We are challenged by the words of Jesus. Our sinfulness is exposed by the words of Jesus. We are chastised and we are challenged to live saintly lives, lives that demonstrate the fruits of the Spirit, patience and joy and kindness and bearing the burdens of one another. We are challenged to seek after and use the spiritual gifts that God has given to us so that the kingdom of God is edified, so that it is grown, so that the good news of Jesus is shared, so that there will be saints who follow us. But it's not about us, right? It's still all about Jesus. And today we hear a word that pronounces upon a number that cannot be counted the blessing of God, the salvation of God, the lavish love of God, the extravagant grace of God, the never-ending mercy of God is pronounced upon us. It is ours. It is yours. It is mine. It belongs to the saints of God who from their labor rest. That's good news. And someone here may want to celebrate with me. Salvation belongs to who? To the works I've done? No, no, no. I am. No, no, no. God is the owner and God is the distributor of salvation. Amen. Glory. If you or I own something, or if you or I were in charge, or think we were in charge, then we think that we can determine what will happen with what we think we own. That's how we are with our possessions. We are possessive of our possessions. I'm not saying that we shouldn't take care of what God has blessed us to have. We should. But I am saying that we tend to be rather possessive with the stuff that we think is ours. Well, the good news today is that salvation is not ours to distribute. It is ours to receive. But the distribution, the granting, the disbursement of salvation, the declaring righteous, the sainthood of an individual is not ours to determine. I'm not a saint because of anything that I've done. You are not a saint because of anything that you have done. Those of us who remember, those of us whom we can give thanks because of what God has done for us, we know that we're not saints because of what we've done. We are saints because of what God has done to us, for us, and what he's doing through us. We are saints, yes indeed, but it's all about Jesus. It's because at just the right time, for those who remember that great cloud of witnesses, for each of us, for that number that cannot be counted, at just the right time, Jesus died, was buried, suffered, was buried again, rose from the dead, and ascended into the heavens so that we could rejoice every day in spite of what goes on in our world, so that we could claim his victory every day, so that we could claim his salvation for ourselves every day, every hour, no matter how we feel, because salvation belongs to him, and he grants it to us. We are in the number. The Bible says the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. We believe this. We put our faith in it. In the eyes of God, the good news is we are saints. Oh, we will be sinners while we walk on this earth. But as far as God is concerned, we are his saints. People who have been cleansed of all of our sin through the blood of Jesus. You see, a saint is someone who realizes that he or she is a sinner, repents of that sin, and believes that the blood of Jesus Christ takes away all of our sin. In our baptism, God cleansed us from our sin by connecting us to the blood of his Son. Again today, when we come to receive Holy Communion, we eat and drink the very body and blood of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, given and shed for you for the forgiveness of your sin. At that moment, you are washing your robe in the blood of the Lamb. You and I are saints in the eyes of God. And maybe, sometimes, secretly, you question your sainthood. Maybe you are always sure or convinced that God can accept sinners, especially if you're feeling guilty or something that you feel is unforgivable. Just have a little talk with Jesus, and he makes it right. Have a little talk with Jesus, and he will fix it just like he said that he would. The number is God is willing for a reason. We cannot limit the depth of God's love and forgiveness. Be certain about this. Through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and the holiness that Jesus achieved for you on the cross, he is calling you to have faith in what he has done for you. That the blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed you of all of your sin. We fail, yes, at times to live up to our part. We acknowledge that we are sinful. That's no secret to anyone who knows us. but we are saints. Where are the saints? Here they are. Here we are, because Christ has taken our sins away. Who are the saints? Where are the saints? It might be a football team for some, but because of Jesus, we are the saints of God, and we are undefeated. God be the glory for the great things that he does for us and through us. Amen.
Amen.